Tranzman. Tranzman is an abbreviation for Transition Manager. This video is a demonstration of how we can use Tranzman appliance to transition across different backup vendors. In this video we will look at migrating from Spectrum Protect, previously known as Tivoli Storage Manager, and from Data Protector into NetBackup. I'll begin by showing that NetBackup currently has no jobs running. We click on the Activity Monitor, and confirm that there are no entries shown in the right-hand pane. Next I will show that the NetBackup catalog is also currently empty. We do this by clicking on Catalog, set a date range going back a few years, and then clicking on Search. The query should be quite quick, and it should return with a message stating, "Found no images or media matching the selection criteria." This indicates that the catalog is empty. So here we're going to install the Tranzman software. We've booted from the install media. It will present you with the end user license agreement. You should read through this and accept its terms if you want to continue. By installing the software, you are agreeing to the terms. Next, we are presented with a list of disk devices we can install to. We will use SDA. We say yes to overwrite the contents of that disk. We've sped up the video for the install, but when it's finished installing, there will be a message telling you that you can now remove the install media and reboot. In our demo, the appliance will be using DHCP. Using a browser, we connect to the IP it was given. When prompted, we will enter the username and password for the admin account. We then select that we are doing cross-product transitioning. We enter demo code for the organization and click on commit. We will then be presented with the volume page where it would present a list of disks that could be used for transient data. In our demo we only have one, so it will auto-configure. It can take a while for the partitioning to take place. The web page will refresh automatically when it's completed. We will update the network settings as required. In this case we will tell it to use a static IP, the IP address, the gateway address, we will give it a fully qualified domain name. We will correct the DNS server entries. We will also update the NTP server to a valid one for our network. We click on commit and wait for the server to reboot. When it reboots, it will redirect us to the new IP. And we need to log back in again. We want Tranzman to start its discovery. This requires use to create an agent package for each of backup environments we will be migrating from or to. We will enter the IP address and then the operating system for each environment to create its agent package. The first one is our NetBackup environment, which is a Linux system. We will now repeat the same process again. This time we enter an IP address. It's going to be for the TSM environment, which is also a Linux system. Now we're going to add the first of our two data protector environments. This one is a Data Protector 10 environment on a Windows system. And then we can add the last environment, which is a Data Protector 9 environment, which is also on a Windows server. This has created a unique packages for each environment. We will download them all, remembering which one was for which environment as it will only work on the system it was intended for. When downloading the Windows packages, it is likely that the system will ask if you want to keep the .exe file. Repeat the download process for each of the packages. Finally, we transfer the respective package to each of the systems where we will install it. So we're going to install the first Linux agent now. We have already copied it into /temp/agent. So we just cd into the /temp/agent path. We make the bin file executable by giving using tumod. We then launch it by typing /agent-name.bin. This extracts and install the agent, and then starts it. We repeat the same process again. We cd into the folder where we copied the agent package. We make the agent package executable by using chmod. We execute the agent package, completing the install and starting the agent. We will now install the first of the two Windows agents. We click on the agent package to start the installer, then we click Next. We review the license agreement as you did when you did the main server install. You click I agree, then you choose the install path. We will use the default install path and click install. You can click on close when the install has completed, and then click OK. Finally, we'll go to the last Windows system to complete the last agent install. OK, so we launch the installer, click Next, then click I agree, and then install, and we let the install run. When done, just click on close and then OK. With the agents installed, it will automatically its discovery process. As you can see, the first one to be discovered was the TSM environment, and we now get a red key symbol on the side, which means that we need to add some credentials. We're going to add the TSM admin account name and its password. Then it'll ask for the DB2 user account. We enter that, and we also enter the password for that as well. It will continue to discover the other environments. You can see that is picked up the two HPE Data Protector environments, and it's discovered the environment names for all of the environments. It's now currently running through the query images and the query media, and we're waiting for those actions to complete. As you can see, we've just got four alerts come in, so we're going to have a closer look at what they are. They're telling us that there's a couple of policy types which we do not currently have a mapping to our internal format. We'll wait for the rest of the query images to complete, as this will populate the rest of the catalog information. With all the query is now complete, we can see that from the dashboard that we also have size protected and image count for all environments. So now we're configuring the devices. Click on device. Wait for it to refresh. It's discovered three libraries, and we're going to configure the density for the three drives. We are using the first library. We choose the densities from the ones that were discovered during the earlier queries media action. We click on each drive and we assign one or more densities to that drive. We repeat the process for as many densities that that drive can support. We repeat this process for all three of the drives in the first library. After finishing that, we inventory. Now we're going to start making some selections. The first thing we need to do is choose what our origin server is, and what our destination server is. We repeat that same process for the two other origins, selecting the same destination for each of them. We then edit the pair to choose which client images are going to be migrated. We are selecting everything here too, and then we click on Save. We can also choose if we want to move any workloads, perform any renames. For now, we're going to go and deselect the IDB for Data Protector, and as it's the catalog backup, it's of no use in the destination environment anyway. We will repeat the same process for the other two selection pairs. Selecting all of the clients and then we save. We select all of the workloads, i.e. And again we remove the IDB workload and press save. We then move on to the third pair. Again we select all of the clients, and save. Then we select the workloads to transfer those across and then we save. Moving on to the duplications, now we choose for each origin which destination storage unit that origin's data will be duplicated to. We click back on duplication so that we can change the second origin's destination storage unit. We go back to duplication and we repeat the process again for the third time. So we click on the license option, it will display information about what is being configured and what was discovered. This information needs to be sent to StoneRAM, who will then provide a license key. The key is added into the box at the bottom and then your system will be enabled to perform the migrations, conversions and duplications. So we have everything selected and configured. Now we just click on the button to start the transition. That's as much as we should really need to do. After that it's just a case of monitoring its progress. Okay, so I'm just going to take you through the different migration states. To start off we would get a total. If we click on each of the pairs you get to see which environments are involved in the pair. You can also see their particular states in terms of the catalog and the data. As we hover over each of these segments you can see. The first one is selected. Second shows exported. And third one is imported. Likewise, if we also look at the data, we have selected, converted and duplicated. We are now going to let the migration run through. We have sped this up for the purposes of the demo. It could take many hours or days depending on the volume of data that you're trying to convert. As you can see, the catalog and data rings keep changing. We will wait until they get to a point where they are no longer changing. Remember how I showed the catalog was empty at the start? Here we will repeat that process. We do this by clicking on Catalog, set a date range going back a few years, and then clicking on Search. This time it returns with a list of all the images we converted. While this demo has been for a migration including data duplication. This is the process whereby our converted data is duplicated onto the destination backup software's own storage devices. If you want to use Tranzman for recovery on demand, only the catalog is converted and ingested into the destination backup product. Backup data is only converted when you try to access it through the destination product. If you try to do a restore, it will try to access the data over a network share from the Tranzman server. Tranzman detects the access request and triggers the conversion. The initial restore attempt in NetBackup will fail, but when the conversion has completed, Tranzman will send a notification alert, and you can try the restore again. With the full duplication, we automate the conversion of all the images, and tell NetBackup to duplicate them to its own storage, making it owned by NetBackup, and there is no further need for Tranzman in its restore process. Okay, so the first restore that I'm going to do will to demonstrate a recovery from a Solaris client to a Linux machine. The original backup was taken using Data Protector, and we're going to restore everything to an alternative location. I'm going to start the restore. And we'll view the progress. As you can see, the progress is updated just as any normal NetBackup restore. So there you have it. We have completed the restore, and there's quite a number of small files in this. We will connect to the console and have a look in the restore folder. We will view the contents of one of the files. My first file .txt. And there you have it, we have now converted a backup that was taken under Data Protector into a format that NetBackup could restore directly. We're going to do another restore. This time the client was backed up using TSM. The client is a Red Hat client, and we're going to tell it to restore its data back to the master server. We will select a short date range at the backups were more recent for this client. We are going to select the entire data folder. We will initiate a restore. We're going to go to an alternate path, /restore. And click on View Progress. And wait for the restore to complete. As you can see there, this is a selection of data that actually spans 7 different images. It would have taken half a minute or more, so I have sped it up fractionally just for the video. Okay, so that's completed, and now we'll go back to the command console, where we can cd into /restored and view the files that have been recovered. Again, we will view one of the files and show the contents. So there you have it, we now have shown a backup that was taken on TSM being restored through NetBackup. So now we're going to show one final restore, a Windows restore of data backed up using Data Protector. The client was Win2K12R2 data. I will set the type to MS Windows. We're going to drill in and select everything in the test folder. And then we initiate the restore. We will use an alternative path for the restore. I'm just making sure the location doesn't already exist. So we're going to put /restore, then start that restore. We will view the progress. So as you can see, the job is now in progress and we just need to wait for that to complete. It's finished, so let's connect to that server and look for the restore folder. There's our data and there is yet another hello world file. So there you have it, we backed up some data under Data Protector and we've restored it through NetBackup. So, there you have it, you have just watched how easy it is to transition between backup products using Tranzman. In addition to the cross-vendor transitioning we have just demonstrated, Tranzman can also be used for transition between the same backup products, we call it same vendor transitioning, and for performing indexing and recovery of backup data without access to the original backup software or the catalog, we call this recovery without vendor. For more details on either of these, please visit the StoneRAM website at www.stoneram.com or subscribe to our YouTube channel.